Dino necks and civility. I'm going to be discussing a web page, which I've listed and which is on the email that I send out, and will be underneath the web page if you wind up looking at this on the internet. There's a comment on it by Timothy Reeves that we'll review as well. And finally, we got started on this ways back. And for those of you who want to see the first part of the discussion, you're welcome to do so. We're going to be picking that up in the middle. By the way, the sauropod is courtesy of Unexplained Mysteries. You can see the website there. The blog site that I was commenting on is called Uncommon Descent, originally started by Bill Dembski, later continued by Denise O'Leary, and currently hosted by Barry Arrington, with O'Leary making frequent comments. The post itself was entitled Dino's Whiplash, and it was written by a fellow who calls himself Tim. It was a blog post that referenced an article in Yahoo.com, which is now, I think they call it orphaned. You can't get the original article. On how it was impossible without unphysiologic constraints for dinosaurs to get blood to their heads while foraging in treetops, which presents an interesting physiologic problem. How do you, pump blood, 50 feet up, 40 feet up, and not have, severe hypertension in the rest of the animal? It's a problem that giraffes solve by putting a very thick skin around them, and just having really high blood pressure. Well, dinosaurs' blood pressures would have to be through the roof pretty much in that case. But anyway, it was during the early part of it, was turned into a discussion of whether intelligent design was theologically viable, which is an interesting shift. And as you'll see, we'll shift back to the original subject in a little while. A fellow by the name of Timothy V. Reeves commented in 2009, and I'm going to skip some of what he has to say. Most of it will be in there, but Paul at 18, he's commenting to me. I have just noticed a reply. Thanks, I'll get back to you. But in the meantime, here's my response to Giappuccio, which I had commented Giappuccio had done a very nice job. By the way, his real name is Giuseppe Puccio, for what it's worth. And that's how some people do their names. Giuppuccio at 16 commented, nice to be back in harness with you discussing these topics. I had approved Giuppuccio's approach. And Reeves says to Giuppuccio, you say the patterns of law and disorder impressed on large swaths of cosmic ontology are no more self-creating and self-sustaining than our living things. And Reeves comments, I absolutely agree, and so I think, all ideists. And beyond religious reasons, there are scientific reasons to believe that, which correspond to what we usually call cosmological idea, especially the various forms of fine-tuning argument. Giuppuccio comments again, why not, or is quoted again, why not a continuous dispensation in the sense of a God always interacting with his creation, although in different ways and at different levels? And Reeves says, perhaps, That's why I keep up with ID to see what the latest thoughts and observations are. Okay, so there may be breaks in the patterns of the normalcy of the law and disorder dispensation that presumably are the essence of ID, those breaks, that is. However, I would like to emphasize that even law and disorder normalcy, as far as I can see, is a contingency and not a logical necessity. That is, the universe depends upon God. And you may relate this to the presentation a couple weeks ago by George Yavor, who made the same point. I suspect we agree on that. Hence, I conclude that law and disorder needs continuous support of some kind from God, who presumably has the proper of aseity, unlike his creation. He does not define aseity, but for what it's worth, it's from the Latin, from self, which means basically God has the property of not having to have something else sustain him. So in one sense, even under normalcy, God is in some sort of continuous supportive relation or interaction, maybe, with his creation. Djibouti on cosmological ID. Yes, I agree. I think cosmological ID is more abstruse, remote, philosophical, obscure, what have you, than biological ID. The latter is far more in your face. Humans seem capable of living with cosmological mysteries and not asking questions about them. These mysteries appear to have less power to pull them up with presumably with a start. As I have already suggested in 15 above, law and disorder seem to be part of the taken-for-granted furniture of life. We tend not to see the stage, but rather the active drama on that stage. Now, somewhere on that, he switched from Giputio to himself, because law and disorder is his own favorite phrase, meaning basically chance and necessity, but with the idea that God is the creator of both. Design versus creation. Yes, a point worth pondering. This point might relate to my manufacture versus finished article distinction and the observation that both are artifacts. Giputio, ID has consensus on the theory that a designer is needed to explain biological information, but not on the nature of the designer and or the methods of implementation of the design itself. And his comment, once again, my view of history and manufacturer's artifact is relevant here. Using this view, history could be considered as much an artifact of ID as the finished article. Tough that history is not as epistemological, I'm assuming that's epistemologically accessible, that is, figure out how it happened, as what comes out of it. Giputio, the lack of philosophical or religious consensus instead is, in my opinion, an inevitable feature of reality. And Reeves' comment, very probably, not all objects are equally accessible and amenable to analysis, history being notoriously difficult. Consensus can't be taken for granted even with evolution. Evolution being a historical object is therefore bound to be subject of robust exchanges even within the evolutionist camp. For example, over the mix of natural selection and genetic drift. How much is which? As some of you may know, that's a conflict in evolutionary theory. Giputio, again, I don't agree. In ID, we definitely don't take the cosmic law and disorder backdrop for granted. And Reeves' comments, I'm very glad to hear that you don't agree. I ought to know that most philosophically savvy ID theorists are well aware of the issues raised by the cosmic backdrop and wouldn't take it for granted. However, I think as a general rule, backdrop issues are easy to overlook and or not to be seen as problematical. Perhaps that's why atheists are so desperate to load law and disorder normalcy with creative efficacy. It obscures the big questions behind a mask of banality, commonplaceness, and even apparent meaninglessness. As I have said above, in agreement with you, Giputio on cosmological ID, yes, I agree. I think cosmological ID is more abstruse, remote, philosophical, or what have you, than biological ID. The latter is far more in your face. Hence, it is easy to obscure profundity in the banalities of normalcy of law and disorder. Consider Olber's, again, that's Olber's paradox. When I first came across the profound issues raised by his paradox, I was absolutely gobsmacked. To think of it, all that from the simple observation that the night sky is black. Until that moment, I had no inkling that an observation available to me on a daily basis had such profound implications. Familiarity breeds apathy. I should probably insert a little comment on Ober's paradox. It's a very simple one. When you look up at the night sky, it looks black. If there were stars in semi-random arrangements, extending infinitely, and had been there for infinite time so that their light could get to us, there would be no area of the sky where you could look and see past the stars into darkness. The night sky should look white. The fact that the night sky is not white proves to a reasonable certainty that the universe is not both infinitely old and infinitely extensive. It might be old but not infinitely extensive, then you could look beyond it. It might be infinitely extensive but not old, and the light from stars hasn't gotten to us yet. But it can't be both. And that has profound implications for how we see the universe. But anyway, so that's what he's talking about. Here's a simple thing. You look up at the night sky and it looks black, and you draw a conclusion from it, and you go, wow, you just destroyed a bunch of theories. Familiarity breeds apathy. Perhaps a theological case could be made for a second creative dispensation on the ground that it provides a more humanly accessible revelation. And boy, does humanity need revelation. The next comment is by Tim, who has been watching all this. And he says, greetings. I very much appreciate both the tenor and content of Timothy V. Reeves, Mr. Biped, whom we haven't read. I've skipped him in order to try to make this streamlined. Paul Giem and Gipuccio's discussion of the limits of science and the relationship of what evolution, ID, and their concomitant worldviews can explain, including problems inherent in managing what we know or might know or think we know. Plainly, such a discussion here on a blog of this type will be left incomplete. However, I encourage all involved to revisit discussions of this type in which science and philosophy are carefully delineated. A very polite thing for him to say. But basically he's saying, what about dino necks? Which was the original subject. And so Timothy Reeves comes back with, thanks Tim, but here's some more waffle, mostly in reply to Paul as he took the trouble to respond. And you skip the first line, Paul at 18. I think you state the issue clearly enough when you say, quote, I agree with the picture that God, law and disorder is a canvas created by God across which he can paint whatever he wants. Both the canvas and the painting are products of God. Saying so does not mean that there is no painting or that God made the canvas so good that it could make the painting itself. The latter is a scientific question, how did it happen, rather than a theological question, could God have done it that way? And this, thus I should have noted that ID not only posits that chance and or non-designed forces cannot explain all the universe, but that designed but readily accessible forces also cannot explain all the universe. Thus, ID makes the prediction that for some event, that is, for example, the origin of life, some combination of chance and readily accessible law, irrespective of whether that chance and law are products of God, will not explain that event. In my terms, it's Reeves' terms, I read that to mean law and disorder, as currently understood, is not sufficient explanation of life. A scientific question, as you point out. This is, of course, the matter I'm investigating and hope to get some light by reading UD, Uncommon Descent. But let me qualify. Archaeology introduces us to a complex enigmatic human ontology, the science of what actually is true, as opposed to the epistemology, how we can know what is true, often only accessible via the imagination. Science has its place in archaeology, but the final attempt at connection with the past may only be possible via imaginative conclusions synthesized from the intellectual nutrients accrued over a lifetime study and general experience of human affairs. The thinking leading up to some archaeologists' conclusions may be very difficult to articulate. Yes, it may be a science, but it is not, quote, rigorous science, end quote. If, as ID theorists suggest, archaeology is a kind of role model for ID, then perhaps this might throw some light on the difficulties ID theorists are having in trying to claim the label of science, especially when it comes to making positive rather than negative claims about the history of life. It's interesting to hear you say, this is again Reeves, in fact, one of the things that I have observed is that the controversy boils down, he's quoting me now, to science versus religion, with the atheists using the theological arguments and the idea adherents sticking with the science, and sometimes to the exclusion of drawing any theological conclusions. And Reeves says, I think the motives here are clear. Atheists are looking for an excuse to shout, not science, a kind of modern-day equivalent of shouting heresy. And the ID theorists want to keep their subject respectable by imbuing it with the prestige of science. Okay, ID and negatively challenging the workability of the current law and disorder view of evolution's mechanisms does mount a robust scientific challenge. But when it comes to moving beyond minimalist design detection logic into a more positive filling in of the spaces at the edge of the map, as it were, the archaeological imagination has to start working overtime. And we then move away from the crisp conclusions available to schoolroom Bunsen burner science into a fuzzier and more misty world. That is, you can detect design. Who and how and why caused the design is a lot more fuzzy. But there seems to be no choice. Complex ontologies, especially if they are the stamping ground of intelligent actions, produce such a baffling profusion of angles and perspectives that knowledge about them can only be gained from the long existential exposure to them in life in general. Science, when it is faced with complex realities, is forced to be far more imaginatively interpretive than passively inductive or even proactively deductive. And I would agree with him. I mean, look at archaeology. It's science, but science, if you can still call it that, then has to move over to an activity that has more in common with our handling of personalities. I would agree. In fact, maybe of God's personality. Personalities are such complex and fickle entities that we spend much more time interpreting their output rather than predicting it. I'm reminded of ethno-methodology at this point. I'm not saying ID is irrational. I'm just saying that ID theorists have got their interpretive work cut out, just like archaeologists. I suppose we just have to say tough. It says, Gipuccio says, an inevitable feature of reality. On the whole, I try to adopt a generous attitude toward ID and the epistemological difficulties it faces, perhaps because in some ways I'm in a similar position. But the fact is that given that large swaths of positive ID are about stuff within an ontology that is not readily accessible, can't really figure out what it really is, it doesn't classify as Bunsen burner laboratory science. It is of necessity rather fuzzy in some of its departments. Unfortunately, this will give many atheists a pretext to cock the guns as soon as you look at you. I'm sure he meant to say they look at you. Now, I reply to this. Timothy, thanks for your reply. I am largely in agreement with your points. I particularly appreciated your use of archaeology as an example. It is very difficult to correctly synthesize the story behind an artifact, as you noted. Archaeology may be science, but it is not the same kind of rigorous science that physics or chemistry is. You say that if, as ID theorists suggest, archaeology is a kind of role model for ID, then perhaps this might throw some light on the difficulties of ID theorists that are having in trying to claim the label of science, especially when it comes to making positive rather than negative claims about the history of life. This would be true if the primary claim of ID was that a particular story could be told from the artifacts. What needs to be kept in mind is that the historical science, in particular evolutionary biology, but I would include historical geology, suffer from the same weakness. As you say elsewhere, not all objects are equally accessible and amenable to analysis, history being notoriously difficult. Anybody who has trouble believing that just needs to look at our attempts to predict the weather. We do pretty good for a couple of days. Thus, evolutionary biologists are in no position to criticize ID in this regard. Furthermore, just as one may find a stone blade and be virtually certain that it was designed without knowing which tribe designed it, or whether it was intended for butchering, scraping hides, or a ceremonial gift, or perhaps all three, or some other use, it seems that one can make a virtually certain argument about life, that is, life being designed, without knowing what its maker or maker intended. Thus, pure ID may be on much less shaky ground than any particular causal story. This means that the charge that ID must have more content to be valid is wrong-headed. Thus, I agree with your comment, okay, ID and negatively challenging the workability of the current law and disorder view of evolution's mechanism does mount a robust scientific challenge, but when it moves on beyond minimalist design, we just read this not too long, design detection to a fuzzier and more misty world. I also agree with your next comment, but there seems to be no choice. Complex ontologies, especially if they're a stamping ground of intelligent action, produce such a baffling profusion of angles and perspectives that knowledge about them can only be gained from long existential exposure to them in life in general. And so forth. As you said later, tough. That's life. And it can make us, unfair, targets of atheists. But there is one important point. One cannot even begin to tell the story behind an artifact until one recognizes it as an artifact. As long as every attempt to identify life as an artifact is shouted down, it will take extremely steady nerves to ignore the shouting and try to construct a cohesive account of the artifact. People here are understandably a little gun-shy in this regard. Skipping on, yeah, I actually skipped something I said. Then I comment about Tim. Thanks for being so kind to us while we hijack your thread. And then I said, I think I can appreciate your sentiments on finding out that a just-so story had a flaw. Dino necks got gradually longer and longer until they reached, and they just kept out-competing everybody. And that's why they are so tall, so they can munch the treetops. If true, it would decrease one's comfort with other just-so stories. And you are right about the difficulty making predictions about using evolutionary theory. Any theory that predicts correctly half the time in binary situations will have lots of anecdotal evidence to support it, even though its predictive power is no better than coin flipping. Perhaps this is how astrology can still retain the allegiance of some who do not think too critically. Skipping on. However, one needs to be careful about the supposed clear proof that long-necked dinosaurs couldn't have fed from high tree branches. There is a major difference between modern reptilian and modern mammalian physiology. If one removes circulation to a human brain, for example, the human will go unconscious within 15 seconds and often less. However, with snakes and turtles, for instance, this is not true. A poisonous snake may bite a half an hour after the head is cut off from the heart. And snapping turtle heads have been observed to bite objects placed in front of them for a similar time. And also, by the way, move their eyes. It is possible that dinosaur physiology was closer to that of snakes and turtles than humans. Actually, probable. In that case, the head could go on munching for minutes after it lost its blood supply, and the animal would only have to lower its head periodically to allow blood to reflow to the head. This apparently is related to the use of glycolysis for energy rather than aerobic respiration, but there may be some comparative physiologists that know more about the phenomenon. Another phenomenon may be important. Some dinosaurs had a ganglion at the base of the vertebral column in their tail, well, just before their tail, that was actually larger than the brain. This basal ganglion may have helped to keep the animal functional when the brain was not functioning at peak performance. So Mwag has written a funny poem about this, which I will not reproduce because of copyright issues, but which can be found at the link. Behold the mighty dinosaur, famous in prehistoric lore, not only for his whatever in strength, but for his intellectual girth and length, I think, but for his intellectual strength. And the idea is that he had an extra brain so he could have an afterthought. And this is done very nicely in, in poetic language. So we need to be a little cautious about our claim that long-necked dinosaurs couldn't have raised their necks high for long periods of time. And Tim comes back. Excellent. I wrote in my post that I don't know much about dinosaurs. And your last post taught me a few interesting things that I will probably soon, unfortunately, probably forget. It bears repeating that concerning the structures of sauropod necks, what we are looking for is clear proof. I'll be the first to admit I don't have it. But you've actually absolutely nailed the point of my post. There is no care involved in the dissemination of scientific knowledge when it comes to evolution. For the evolutionary thinker needing an explanation, any explanation, natural selection is, quote, clear proof, end quote. The stories, when they finally reach the general public, are also certain. That certainty is not always a bad thing in science. After all, we have to have confidence of some sort in the contingent truths derived by scientific studies. We so often hear of the overwhelming evidence of evolution. Consider the reproductive advantage of upright necks for foraging the canopy. Well, is that part of the overwhelming evidence or not? It is interesting that here on this blog we are now learning, a little bit earlier I skipped over this, that it is not for foraging, but for dominance and mating. Did I get that right? That long necks are important, or for those species with long necks at any rate. Actually, it's talking about giraffes, that apparently the male giraffes whack the whatever out of each other in competition for females. The swapping in and out of stories or theories or models or whatever, but always with the same arbitrary conclusion that evolution is a fact, is an artifact of this area of science that I have noticed in no other area of science. I think he has a complaint there. What I find so distressing is this double motion of certainty when evolutionary just-so stories reach the public. In physics, for years, countless experiments had confirmed the equation F equals ma. When physicists finally, I'm sure that's plural, began to study the very small and very fast, the contingency of the truths of F equals ma became more and more apparent. At the smallest levels of the physical world, I gather, F equals ma has little or no explanatory power at all. I would say more the fastest rather than the smallest, but I don't know the first source of evolution is a fact, and I prefer not going into that seemingly endless discussion of what is meant by fact. But as I look back to the structure of upright sauropod necks and how they're explained by natural selection acting on random genetic mutations within sauropod populations, I find that any thought of contingency is, consciously maybe, omitted. F equals ma was not overthrown for large, relatively slow objects when it was found not to apply to the very small and fast, but it was constrained. Finchbeaks and their microevolution in adapting to climate change would be an appropriate example of working within reasonable constraints. Why isn't the idea of natural selection constrained for novel biological structures? Why is it, I assume, allowed to run amok? I'd suggest that this is because of nothing more than ideological prejudice. So that's Tim kind of reinterpreting or interpreting, maybe I should say, his initial post. Timothy Reeves comes back and says, Tim, let me also apologize for helping to take things off at a tangent. Returning to the subject of dinosaur necks, Paul's comments on dinosaur brains are very interesting. A closer look at bioengineering by someone of his background reveals new impinging issues, namely the resilience of reptilian brains to blood supply interruption. This seems to put the conventional evolutionary explanation of the length of dinosaur necks back on the agenda of possibility, if not certainty. This reminds me of something I said at 5 above. Evolution's inherent complexity ensures that it has many variables, adjustable conditions, and degrees of freedom, etc. This in turn leads to the volatility of evolutionary explanations. Its many degrees of freedom give it an extraordinary flexibility in the face of challenging data as it readapts to explain these new challenges by slipping and sliding its many internal variables to create a fit. As far as the human mind's ability to comprehend is concerned, evolution scenarios are open-ended affairs. And an expert with a different mindset, for example, Paul here, may import new knowledge that leads to reinterpretation. However, given the necessary complexity of the proposed ontology of evolution, I try to be generous with evolution's Proteus-like nature and the ability of its explanations to morph their way around new data. Likewise, I try to be generous with the ID community's difficulty in arriving at a consensus that goes beyond design detection. See my last post. Given that both sides of the ID evolution debate have their own sets of problems, what would end the angst of the ID community? That evolutionists simply give up their claim to intellectual hegemony and concede some kind of academic parity? Well, yeah. And then I comment back, I appreciate your fairness to both sides of the debate, all three sides, all 20 sides. I would point out something that may have been overlooked. While it looks like I was just being fair to the non-interventionist evolutionary community, and in one sense I was, in another sense I was operating from a design perspective. Brachiosaurus existed, whether partly or completely designed or completely undesigned or even in what time frame. In order to grow a 25-foot neck, the animal individually first had to grow a 20-foot neck. Saltation may be an adequate theory for the kind of animal, but except possibly in the case of butterflies, which has metamorphosis, it is totally inadequate for any individual member of the species. That means that the necks had to be functional enough to reach the lengths they did. Some dinosaurs had four legs longer than their hind legs, and Brachiosaurus is one of them, suggesting to those of us who accept design that they were designed to reach upward with their heads. Thus, there would have to be some kind of design features that countered the problem of getting blood to the head. In giraffes, this is simply high blood pressure and adaptations that allow the high blood pressure to exist without killing the animal prematurely. In dinosaurs, perhaps it was adaptations that allowed the brains and other tissues to function for extended periods of time without blood supply at all. We could perhaps call this the weak dinosauric principle, or maybe the weak organismic principle, WOP anyone. And an organism had to be at least minimally functional, or we would not have found it. This principle exists regardless of how that organismal type came to be in the first place. Thus, my explanation is not really a defense of evolutionary theory, unguided or otherwise. This claiming of irrelevant considerations as support for evolutionary theory is done all the time, and it confuses the discussion. If one wants to make a case for unguided evolution, what one really wants to say is something like this. There are five genes controlling the neck length in dinosaurs. All of these genes have a functional range in short dinosaurs, say Stegosaurus, that is within one mutation of the long-necked variety functional range, except one, which has a no dinosaur's land of one mutation between the short and the long-necked forms. The necks grew longer with each mutation, allowing the dinosaurs to eat progressively higher foliage and be naturally selected over millions of years. That one gene, through a lucky two simultaneous mutations, was able to jump the gap and produce the long necks we now can see in the fossil record. None of these mutations are outside the probability bounds that can reasonably be set for dinosaur herds of tens of thousands for millions of years. That is the kind of explanation that would sew up the unguided evolutionary explanation in this area. Of course, we don't have any DNA from Brachiosaurus, let alone the putative ancestor. And we have no idea which genes we should be looking for to determine neck length. So at present, it is simply a matter of faith whether such pathways exist or not. With the bacterial flagellum, we can tell precisely how many genes are required in each organism and how many supporting genes are required and in what order they are transcribed. And nobody, not even Mansky, has come close to giving the kind of account that must be there if unguided evolutionary theory is correct. You speak of evolution's Proteus-like nature and the ability of its explanations to morph their way around new data. If taken to the extreme, that takes evolution completely out of the realm of science. Let me explain. The essence of history is recording and explaining the past. One is tempted to say simply recording, but that's not the case. There is just too much data to report everything. So there must be some choice as to which parts of history are important enough to repeat, and that means we need a framework that helps us to understand which parts are important, which parts are not. That is, we're not just reporting, we are explaining. Evolution is, in fact, history. Whether it's good history is another question. But evolution claims to be science as well. It is well to ask the nature of science. Science is intended to be objective. That is why we do experiments with controls, and in cases where we suspect that observer bias may influence the results, we insist on blinding. This makes science congenitally opposed to postmodernism. Some would say that it is, with mathematics, the last outpost of defense against postmodernism in academia. But science has had to give up any pretense to being able to prove absolute truth, where mathematics can still make that claim. What science can claim to do is to falsify theories. And this is the insight of Popper. It turns out to be not quite that simple. The problem with Popper's hypothesis is that scientists do not go around making up theories and falsifying them. They strive for a theory that is not falsified, particularly a theory that could be falsified but has not been and has survived testing. That's what scientists really want. They want the truth. And finding out what's false is only a tool. Furthermore, falsifiability turns out to be the precise reverse of the coin of predictability. A good scientific theory says that given conditions 1 through 5, we will see resultant A and not B, C, D, or E. The tighter the constraints, the better the theory is at prediction. However, the tighter the constraints, the easier it is to falsify the theory. If you want a theory to be predictive and therefore useful, it must be falsifiable. There's no logical way of getting around that. Theories get particular credit for sticking their necks out where they could get chopped off, and other theories would expect their necks to be chopped off and surviving. Thus, when some scientists predicted the existence of Neptune from irregularities in the movement of Uranus, those scientists gained tremendous stature along with Newtonian physics when Neptune was found. This cuts both ways. Irregularities in the orbit of Mercury that couldn't be explained by Newtonian physics led to its downfall and to the rise of relativistic physics. The point is, if unguided, evolutionary biology can explain everything equally well, it actually is a totally useless theory. And in an important sense can be said not to be scientific. Its predictive power, to paraphrase Anthony Flew in his younger days, dies the death of 1,000 qualifications. If a theory cannot predict, it is not science. It may be history, it may be good history, but it is not science. That, I think, is part of the frustration that Tim feels about dinosaur necks, and now about giraffe necks as well, or perhaps instead. Given that both sides, and here I'm quoting Timothy Reeves, that both sides of the idea evolution debate have their own set of problems, would it be a good idea that evolutionists simply give up their claim to intellectual hegemony and concede some kind of academic parity? And I said, yep, exactly. We think that we can win if the playing field is level. I suspect our opponents are afraid this is the case also, and that is why they persist in trying to keep the playing field from becoming level. How many believers in astrology do you know that were denied tenure? Nobody panics in physics if somebody denies relativity, and there are some who do. And then we get an entrance from Can. I don't know who Can is, but he comments, how many believers in astrology do you know that were denied tenure? And he says, this is irrelevant. The question would be how many scientists who study astrology as if it were a serious science are denied tenure. My guess would be all of them, although I haven't heard of any cases. And then, quoting me, nobody panics in physics if someone denies relativity, and there are some who do. He says, do any of these that deny relativity suggest an intelligent force as an alternative explanation? So I replied to him, thanks for your comments. They are revealing. If one believes in astrology, one believes that the position of the stars influences human personality and behavior. That's what astrology is. Whether these influences exist is at least theoretically a testable question. That makes it science. Perhaps bad science, but science. What you're saying is that if you ran academia, scientists could believe in astrology as long as they didn't actually believe in it. What would happen if a scientist tested an astrological theory? Would you allow publication of the results only as long as the results showed that astrology was discredited? If so, what good are such cherry-picked results in discrediting astrology? Can't you see that this way of proceeding reduces science to precisely what postmodernists claim science is? Science then does become nothing more than a power struggle and loses all valid claims to truth. Don't get me wrong, I don't believe in astrology. But if astrology doesn't lose in a fair fight, it can't be truly said to have lost. And then he's quoting me, nobody panics in physics if somebody denies relativity, and there's some who do, and he said, do any of these that deny relativity suggest an intelligent force as an alternative explanation? So I comment back, I see. Anyone that believes that an intelligent force can do anything, or even suggest such a force, must be banned from the scientific community. You must have hated Star Wars. Or maybe it's okay as long as we're doing make-believe. Let's tease that apart. Should SETI researchers be banned from the scientific community? They do believe in intelligent forces that are empirically detectable. Well, should believers in panspermia be banned from the scientific community? If Fred Hoyle came up for tenure, or Chandra Wickramasinghe, or Francis Crick, and your vote decided, would you, A, allow them because otherwise they're good scientists, B, count it against them but let them pass if their credentials were otherwise excellent enough to outweigh this flaw, or C, deny tenure regardless of their other accomplishments and abilities? This flaw is fatal. After all, Dawkins thought that an extraterrestrial origin of life, as long as the extraterrestrials were naturalistic, was an intriguing possibility. Now, three, should believers in God be banned? If Francis Collins or Kenneth Miller came up for tenure, would you pass them, make them jump them through extra hoops, or fail them? Should believers in an interventionist God be banned? If Guillermo Gonzalez, who didn't even challenge evolution in the biological world, came up for tenure, would you pass him, make him jump through extra hoops, or fail him? Should believers in young earth creationism be banned? If Isaac Newton came up for tenure, would you pass him, make him jump through extra hoops, or fail him? After you've thought about those questions, may I suggest a possible policy? In the movie Expelled, William Provine is quoted as saying he doesn't care what people believe as long as they understand the theory. His actions at Cornell, where he teaches a course, this is before he died, so I didn't put it in past tense, and invites various members of opposing viewpoints to present with him, suggests that he really means this. Stephen Jay Gould actually allowed a young earth creationist, Kurt Wise, to get his PhD from Harvard. Is it really that wrong to allow tolerance and plurality into science and to put the lie to the claim that it's all about power and not about truth? So, Can comes back. Well, here's the deal. Being a scientist is about two things, getting grant money and publishing papers. Whoa! If you don't do these things, you get fired or become a full-time teacher or administrator. If you can't do those things, you can believe in whatever you want. If you can find a way to research astrology and get funded and published, good for you. It would be extremely hard to do because astrology has been debunked numerous times already, so it would be a foolish thing for, say, an untenured professor to do. Despite your reading into my words, all I'm saying is that if you want to be a professional scientist, you have to do science. Your beliefs are irrelevant. Interesting. We'll allow comments very shortly. Tim comes back and says, I appreciate all the comments. I'll be closing down the comments for this thread now, as I feel we have adequately, if not comprehensively, discussed the matter. Special thanks to Timothy V. Reeves for an openness that speaks to his character and to Paul Giem for writing what I meant. And anyway, so Can didn't get any response. Now, a little later, I was looking through the internet for something else, and I ran across this, the Greenhouse Event at Uncommon Descent, and it's by a blog that's run by Timothy Reeves. Comments on this thread on UD where I was in discussion with Paul Giem are now closed. What I regard as the most important thing to come out of this discussion was the complete absence of animosity. This is doing well, considering that Paul Giem is a young Earth creationist and probably well displaced from my own position on several issues. In contrast, if people start out with the opinion that the other side is populated by malign boneheads and treat them as such, then I see no hope of progress in the evolution ID debate. However, the thread leaves a number of loose ends. One, Paul's suggestion that long dinosaur necks are likely to require the simultaneous operation of several functioning parts / genes is likely to be correct. This is, of course, another special case rendition of the irreducible complexity question. But the apparent irreducible complexity here doesn't automatically entail intelligent design in the UD sense. And I'll leave you with the question, do you agree? Two, I'm not sure how far Paul has come to grips with the idea that ontological accessibility and or complexity generates a sliding scale of scientific tractability that both sides of the debate use against one another. And I'll leave you with the question, is he right? What should we do about it? And three, UD supporters may have consensus when it comes to knocking evolution, but little consensus on the positive aspects of their theory, just how life came to be. This department of their theory seems to suffer from greater problems of scientific tractability than even evolutionary theory. People who live in greenhouses, he means glass houses, he has a picture of a glass house with some people launching stones from a catapult, shouldn't throw stones, and that applies to both evolutionists and ID theorists. Anyway, usually I'll give you comments, but since you've been hearing my comments all the way through, I'm going to just turn it over to you right now. And just keep it for now. Okay, go ahead.
I move to comment on the title, Civility. I think what I detect is superb ability to write. And I certainly do congratulate you particularly. I don't know that I very, very rarely encountered such clarity of such murky concepts. It sounds only in retrospect clear, but it didn't until you wrote it. And it's very civil of you to merely dismiss it as civility. And those of us who have tried to essay some of these things, particularly in the ontological, philosophical perspective, must have nothing but great admiration for the way you put it, and your colleagues that you've been blogging with. Now, I'd also like to interpose what us old Adventists consider a rather cherished concept, if it's not just a prophecy, and that is the event that will take place that we sometimes talk about, and we don't talk about it very much because I don't know that we can even begin to understand it. It's incomprehensible. But will take place at the end of the second round when Satan attempts to conquer the New Jerusalem. At that moment, the whole scenario is interrupted when Christ will be elevated above what? I don't really know, but up there. Maybe it's metaphorical. And this is the part that we have talked about, but not much. Supernaturally, everything will become clear to everybody in the whole universe. Now that is a miracle transcending even your ability to describe things.
I'm afraid I have to agree with you on that one.
My reaction to this excellent discussion, incidentally, really, really good. It to me brings out an issue, an important issue, and that is the definition of our terms. And I've referred to this earlier. But I think it bears repeating here. Who is doing more speculating, the evolutionist or the creationist? And as such, who do you call the scientist? And who do you call the person of faith? And in terms of I can't explain where God came from, and there are many things I cannot explain, you know, how God performs miracles and all this. I have a lot of questions. But in terms of the simple science, I can raise the question that it seems to me that the scientists are more the men of faith than are the creationists. And this is alluded to in your comments there, it was alluded to. That, but we're trapped. We're trapped by attitudes, and we're trapped by popular opinions, and even deeper thoughts that don't ask the deeper questions. And our whole society is trapped in this, and whether it's science or politics, you're all trapped into these things, and we need to be more rigorous, dig deeper. We're never going to get to the bottom, but we ought to dig a little deeper and raise more questions about what we're assuming to be true as we look for truth.
Yes.
Go ahead while they're switching the mic.
Okay. One question I had was in the talk about where Karl Popper came up, I found interesting the discussion of science and the definitions, like he was saying, of whether something was falsifiable, whether it qualified it as science, and whether the issue of, okay, so my understanding of Karl Popper's was kind of the approach of that to prove something true, you go about and you start chopping at everything, and that which survives becomes truth. And I thought it was what I took away from the discussion is that we have to kind of limit the things we define science to a kind of a smaller area if we're going to take that approach, and other things are still useful. So much of it to definitions. Are we going to define science as a small thing that can survive such an approach to science? One thing that I was wanting to bring up was my concern is from personal experience, I've found the Karl Popper, I'm assuming, kind of that type of approach of looking at the world around you and it's like, okay, what can I chop off to then prove that something is not a right theory, goes too quickly to not actually listening to a community, people, whatever, a theory long enough to say, okay, well, what are you actually trying to say? Or maybe there's some other way to approach it instead of, and so the kind of that need to take time to listen to other theories. And so my question is on the danger of going too quickly to chopping.
Well, I think Karl Popper saw something that was important. And I don't think he understood fully why it was important. Here I am pontificating on Karl Popper, but anyway. But where he first ran across it was a very simple proposition. Einstein said, if the star is not at this point, then my theory is wrong. Whereas he was used to dealing with two groups of people, the Freudians and the Marxists. And anything that happened could be fitted comfortably into their theory. And he felt really uncomfortable calling that kind of philosophy science. And I think he's right. But he went on from there to say, well, what's really important is its falsifiability. And what I think really is important is not falsifiability, because falsifiable theories that are falsified kind of get thrown in the scrap heap. The ones they keep are the ones that could be falsifiable but aren't. And, Newton's theory until it ran into Mercury was a good example where, it said, well, you wait 20 days and Mars will be found here. Exactly here. And, well, you can calculate there's a probably, because we don't know exactly where all the mass in the solar system is, there's a small area around which it could be found and still be legitimate. And partly because of, your observing equipment and so forth. But the idea is that there was a very small range that was compatible with Newton's theory. And in fact, when Uranus didn't seem to fit that pattern, somebody said, well, maybe there's another planet out there. And they found Neptune. And they found it pretty much in the area where people had calculated it ought to be. That's really astounding. And that's the way science is supposed to be. It's supposed to be able to take data and, first of all, predict, and secondly, if it doesn't predict entirely, to be able to say, but there may be one or two fudge factors that we put in here, and then it fits. Whereas, Marxism, well, if there's a revolution, well, it was time. If it wasn't a revolution, it wasn't time yet. I mean, what do you do with something like that? It would be interesting to see what Marx does with the fall of the Soviet Union. But there are still Marxists in the... well, that was Lenin. That wasn't Marx, see? And so if you have a theory that has enough fudge factors, it can fit anything. But then you can't use it for predictions. And that's the fundamental positive of which Popper's falsifiability was really the reverse coin.
Yeah, just whether there's danger in pushing that too far and taking out the field where there's usefulness and explanatory power and ability to do things, where if you take that approach, then you cut out a whole bunch of things that are not yet to the point where you can... We don't have objectivity. Objectivity is a hard thing to find.
Yeah. And that's one of those things that eventually what we have to say is, this area here is not science yet. Somebody may figure out a theory that makes sense of it all, and if they do, good for them, and we'll accept it as far as it goes, and we'll start using it to make predictions, and hopefully our predictions will be good.
That brings an interesting question about how do we come up with explanation, satisfying explanations, which are satisfying to us. You see, I suspect it is not usually that we land on an explanation because we have firm knowledge about something, but rather because we have preferred concepts and ideas which we had already a priori embraced. And because we already have these concepts internalized, now the explanations come readily to us and serve to, at the same time, strengthen our position as well as kind of rationalize our orientation towards whatever is happening. It does not necessarily relate to truth in that sense. And this is one of the cautions, because it is frequently, it boils down to our personal inclinations. And why are we inclined more in one direction versus some other one? These are the kinds of issues that deal with what is it that makes one person see things one way rather than some other way. And why we sometimes feel like banging our heads against the wall when we are trying to explain something to one another.
So one thing I like about the scientific process is that there is sort of, to some extent, there's agreed upon rules in terms of how to figure out what is true. You know, in statistics, we chose p-value of less than 0.05, and it helps, you know.
And if you really, really want to get technical, and the physics people need to be really convinced, they'll choose 5 standard deviations, which is a p-value of, I don't know, 1 in a million or something.
Right, right. So I think there's utility in having rules for determining, you know, what truth is. In these discussions that you had up on the screen, what I found is that I think there is fair-minded discussion going on, and I think there was probably some progress. But I don't know that there is a formal process. I mean, there's blogs and you can comment, but at the end of the day, was there a solid progress upon which, you know, providing a foundation for which you can go ahead and move on, like in the scientific process? So I guess I'm throwing out the question is, could there be some sort of almost formalized rules of discussion where perhaps maybe you need to exclude unreasonable people, whatever that means, have moderates, and... maybe if somebody concedes one side, then that's noted and it's placed in a registry or something like that. I have no idea what this process would be, but let me just throw it out there.
Well, actually, I think the internet itself provides a certain amount of that, because as you'll notice, one of the things that we can do is we can go back to quoting what they said so that there isn't a way, but I never said that, you know, of wiggling out of it, which is... They still try, but it's a lot harder if you've got your comments in black and white. It really is.
Because of the evidence of tweets of late.
Yes. Yes.
It has become common practice not to rely on factual truth, but rather to speak in order to generate an effect. And when you start doing that, people, neither the speaker nor the listener cares whether it's true, whether what is said is in fact true. Everybody is just only looking for an appropriate effect.
I will have to say this. The comments are a bit longer than 140 characters apiece.
Yes. So yeah, this was not in that category, but you may, alluding to political events of late, You probably see that phenomenon.
Oh, yes.
That in print is often described as BS flinging.
Okay. Yes, and sometimes that is done precisely for that effect, to turn the other party into a tizzy, so that they, oh, he couldn't have said that.
So I ask the questions. There could be a process, and I have heard you say, well, to some extent, that process exists. On the internet, you can at least quote people. That's correct, but I don't think that that's sufficient. I'm wondering if there could be more, if there could be a process developed.
Well, the other problem that you have is that you have somebody who's staked out a position and is now clearly losing the argument. Well, they can do one or two things. They can declare victory and run away. Like I said, several things they can do. They can just disappear. They can say, well, you misquoted me. That was out of context. I didn't mean that. So even if you're doing precise quoting of precisely what they said with an attempt to understand it, if one wants to, one can avoid the implications of the evidence.
But could there be a formal process put in place where that would punish that sort of behavior, to where maybe there's people who almost act as jurors, that they say, we recognize what the person is avoiding, responding or whatnot, or we judge that this is a strong argument, this isn't. I don't know what the answer is, but I'm throwing it out there.
I think unless you actually have the person themselves make that judgment, it's pretty hard to make it stick, because they'll just tell you that you have the wrong jury. The fact of the matter is, if you want to maintain a position strongly enough against all combinations of evidence, you can do that. And there's nobody that can make you in the final analysis. You may be able to have them make choices that are very uncomfortable for them. But in the end, if somebody wants to maintain that they're right, regardless of what the facts, as anybody else sees it or as you see it, seem to be, they can always kind of, in a way, make up their own facts.
As amply demonstrated by the political system.
Yes. It is something that really people have to kind of start out by agreeing to the rules ahead of time. And then when it starts cutting across their favorite theories, they have to submit to the rules. Unless they do that. And I have even seen it where people do that, and then later on, for some other reason, they don't like what seems to have been the consensus conclusion, and they go back on it. Well, when I said that, I wasn't thinking about this case.
Right. Well, with the scientific process as it's played out, somebody could say, well, I have strong belief that, whatever, pick your theory, and they do experiments, and the results come up p-value of 0.1, not meeting the criteria.
Yeah.
They could say, well, I don't like the rules, and I'm going to still stick to my opinion, but they're going to have a hard time getting accepted given the rules that are established. Right? They're going to have a
yeah.
hard time.
Well, one of the things that we were able to do here, I think, is to come to enough agreement to where people on the outside could see, A, what we were talking about, B, what we were agreeing on, and C, hopefully, that it made sense to them, too. And I think that that's really what you're trying to do, is you're trying to appeal to people's reason. And, you know, you even there, you can't, I mean, if there are some people on the internet that would read that whole thing and they would go, ah, that's a bunch of hooey, they're just all prejudiced, and
right.
they'd write it off. And they wouldn't even engage. And I think one of the things that's remarkable is that we were able to engage, and I think it made a difference. But it will only make a difference if people want it to and are willing to admit that it should.
So no ideas for any new design of formal process besides what currently exists?
If it was all a matter of logical argument and what came from the rules and stuff, I am sure that God could argue the devil into heaven. The devil has decided that his one idea is not going to be abrogated. That is, that I know best. That everything has to pass through me before I'm going to admit to it. And there's no defense against that argument.
You know, I think there is a process to truth. There is a process. I've used it and it works. And that's the process of elimination. That I've used it in electronics. I fixed some really complicated stuff because of that. And you know why I think I hit the truth? Is because it works. Now, the problem, when I was done, it was worked anyway. The problem with what we're doing with science here, we're doing this process of elimination, and we don't know what it's supposed to do when it works. You know, that's probably part of the problem right there. We're kind of floating around in space somewhere. But at least when you have some object to go to, something that will end up performing like you think it's supposed to perform, well then...
Well, how about accurate prediction as evidence of working? The theory works because it predicts.
It predicts?
Yeah.
Well, that isn't that the process of prediction, is to find what works?
Well, that's right. Prediction is to say that if you do this and this and this and this, then you'll get this result.
Yeah, so what can I say?
Anyway.
One more. Dr. Roth took my original speech out of my mouth about the whole debate here is about definitions. And having the ability as finite individuals to define science, which is defining all of reality, right? The goal of science is to define all of reality. And we're just puny little minds trying to get a handle on it. So that's one problem. Another thing I was going to mention, what Doug mentioned, is establishing rules in the debate. I'm a bit of a negativist on that. I don't think two parties or three or more parties with such divergent views can ever come together and agree on rules. Namely, your excellent presentation showed the problem with it. The problem is you can change the rules as you go in the debate, right? It was very obvious. And you had one party in the thread that finally came up with the bombshell of the whole discussion and saying that science is all about funding and publishing. Can't you just see that's a blatant change of rules right in the middle of the discussion? So...
It has nothing
negative
to do with truth. And I just went, whoa.
So I'm a bit of a negativist when it comes to rules.
Is that a joking?
I think it was. No,
the problem I have, I'll tell you the truth. This guy is speaking for a number of other people.
That's true.
For whom they think that this is what science is about.
Exactly. They operate
on
that
principle. And the truth of the matter is that it's convenient because whenever they get in a bind, they can just say, but that's say science is, and you got to accept it. And of course, then my next question is, well, what do you do if you're a Russian and Lysenko is in charge of your agricultural program and you start denying Mendelian heredity? Now where do you go? Does this guy determine truth, or is he just somebody spouting off who doesn't really know what he's talking about? Mm-hmm. And it seems to me that science was designed so that people like that couldn't run it.
So,
and it should be designed so people like that can't run it.
My analysis of what's happening there, I think he has a legitimate point to say that, you know, you've got to publish and so on. What they're doing is taking the final test of what is truth out of the realm of reality and putting it in the hands of a few. Because you have a funding agency, they become then the test of what can go through the filters and through the hoops and so on. They became a test. And these
they're
are
now
human
God.
Beings. And then the other test is when it comes to publishing, you have an editorial committee and peer review. So you're taking all of science, putting that into these two baskets composed of fallible human minds.
Right. And think about it now. I mean, this could get really uncomfortable. Let us suppose that Trump names a new somebody to the NIH, and their philosophy is now creationist. As a matter of fact, one of his scientific people is reportedly a creationist, a young Earth creationist. I mean, 6,000 years young Earth. Okay.
Well, Ronald Reagan was too.
Well, yeah, but I mean, he didn't mess with the NIH too much.
No, he didn't.
Maybe Trump won't either. But you know, supposing he does something like that, and now the committee is created out of creationists, and now the funding is all done on a creationist model, and the peer review articles, by and large, switch over too because they know which side their bread is buttered on. And so now, if you go evolutionist, even long age, you don't get funded. You don't get published. Are you not a scientist anymore? Did we just turn science into a, a branch of politics. I mean,
yeah.
Well, was it a branch of politics before? You know, witness our last week's discussion of Armitage and how he got fired for publishing the peer-reviewed literature. I mean, you know, there are people who are just not asking some really pertinent questions. And that's what strikes me about that those kind of glib comments, is that he would be horrified. I think Khan would be horrified to find out that all of a sudden the only science that counted was creationist. And I don't think that's what he wanted at all. And that's why I asked those carefully designed questions about teasing this apart. You know, do you deny tenure to Isaac Newton? Arguably one of the three or four brightest minds in the history of physics.
And he had funding.
And he had funding. That's the worst part.
Yes,
I mean, you know.
And he published.
And he published. He published one of the at least two most significant papers in physics. Not to mention that he did a bunch of stuff on optics. I mean, on calculus. He was not a one-note Charlie. No, that's when I asked those questions, he went right into, well, but it's all about the funding.
That was an escape clause.
And that's why I say you have to be really careful about if you're going to try to create some kind of logical structure that will hem people in, because I don't think it will. I think people either will voluntarily allow themselves to be hemmed in by logic, or else there's no hemming them in.
My landlady tried to remind me when I was thus frustrated. A man convinced against his will is of the same opinion still. Now, what under those circumstances can we in fact do? There is something that can be done. And here is the suggestion that I would like to propose. What is needed is every individual must reach the point where they're willing to examine the basis on which their own thinking is founded. How does that happen? That happens when they sense within their own thinking a discordance. How do they perceive a discordance? When they see conflicting concepts which they have embraced. They're not going to embrace a concept which they think is wrong. Nobody does that. I don't do that. I am of the opinion that my opinion is the best one I can currently have, because if I thought there was a better one out there, I'd pick it.
And if somebody were to show you that two of your opinions don't really jive with each other, you're going to have to decide, in this case, which one is more important.
Well, yes, I would be curious. I would want to see things from that perspective. But at some point, I would weigh as to what is it that I like to run with for now, until a better way of looking at things surfaces.
Yeah.
You see, and so what is it that we're called to do? We're not called to make other people think different. We're called to be witnesses. We can present what we think. We can present ideas or concepts that have come across our path.
Ones that help us.
The ones that are helpful to our thinking.
Yeah.
And everybody has a choice to pick from among what's presented what is helpful to them. At some point, they will have picked enough things that will allow them to reflect and choose a different position. Mm-hmm. If they wish to go for truth primarily. If, however, they choose whatever happens to be mostly pleasing or mostly appealing to personal agendas or ideologies or something like this, then none of us has either the right or the means to make up somebody else's mind. That is a simple, otherwise we would all be one individual.
God doesn't even do that.
That's right. That would defeat the whole point of having individuals.
Yeah.
I think probably the best method is the one that Christ used.
That's
questions.
Right.
He asked questions of the Sanhedrin, of the priests when he was there at 12 years of age, that were so deeply thought through that it made them think. It made them reverberate for the rest of their lives. A lot of them accepted, a lot of them didn't. But that's what we can do, is ask questions.
I think
very effective if someone is willing to be honest.
Yeah.
To ask a question about something that's unexplainable. What do you think of this?
Yeah.
How do you explain this? And then several different things.
Yeah.
You know, the irreducible complexities.
Yeah.
Making people think of those, if they're honest, will help them to change. We cannot force anyone. I agree totally. And like you said, God doesn't even do that. He wouldn't.
Sure.
That's not part of his makeup.
Yeah.
He won't do that to the devil, but the devil will actually worship him at the end.
Yeah.
Briefly.
You were right.
And then get up and attack the city, like you said.
Yeah.
Exactly my thoughts. The devil's far more intelligent than we are. We're puny in comparison now.
Yeah.
I don't think we will be in heaven, but we are now. We have to realize we are so dependent on the Holy Spirit and God to help us to make right decisions,
yeah,
to make the right path, because we can get so confused,
mm-hmm,
and so mixed up so easily.
Yeah. I think there's one other thing, too, and that is that when we present things, we should be careful not to say, this idea, which you don't have at present, but you need. Because what that instantly does is say to people, well, you have to change. And change is never comfortable. Never. And so you want to do more inviting than you do complaining or criticizing or that kind of stuff. Because if you start doing as soon as you start doing your idea is wrong, here's the right idea, then what happens is that people's defenses go up and they stop you. And you get this kind of phenomenon that we've talked about. And I don't know how well I was able to avoid that, but I tried very hard not to try to tell him that his ideas were wrong, but rather to present things that looked attractive. And I think that that's one of the things that you have to do.
That's what's wonderful.
Anyway, come back next week. We'll see what we can have prepared for you.